pardon for sin and the peace that.
Well, good morning. Let's gather together. It's lovely to see you, and welcome to Holy Trinity. We pray that you just sense the presence of the Lord in this place. That's the only thing that would make us different to anyone else. Moses spoke about it, that unless the Lord's presence goes with us, it's not that we're better than anyone else. We're all the same at the cross. We all need Jesus. But there's something about God's presence with us that makes all the difference in our lives and can make a difference in your life. I'm going to begin with a reading from Isaiah. He's a prophet in the Old Testament, and he spoke about the last days, and he had great hope. Hope for what that future would look like and how we need that hope in these days. In the last days, the mountain of the Lord's temple will be established as the highest of the mountains. It will be exalted above the hills, and all nations will stream to it. Many people will come and say, "Come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord, to the temple of the God of Jacob. He will teach us his ways so that we may walk in his paths." The law will go out from Zion, the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. He will judge between the nations and will settle disputes for many peoples. They will beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not take up sword against nation, nor will they train for war anymore. Come, descendants of Jacob, let us walk in the light of the Lord. Amen. Let's just bow our heads for a moment. We thank you, Lord, for that biblical invitation to come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. And so, Lord, we want to come and we want to walk in your light together. Your word tells us that if we walk in the light as he, Jesus, is in the light, then we have fellowship with one another. And so, Lord, as we do that today, as we hear your word, as we bring our prayers and our cries and our needs before you, as we worship you, hopefully in the way you've taught us to, in spirit and in truth, we pray that we would experience true fellowship with one another. Lord, send forth your light and your truth. Let them be guides to each one of us as we come. In the name of Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let's stand together and let's worship the Lord. Hello.
Love, you bring light to the dark.
Amen. Great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. I've got my phone with me right at the moment, which I don't usually hold in church, but I'm doing that because all of us, you know, our hearts are being stirred by the constant images we're seeing on the news and what's happening in Ukraine and in the war there. And a couple of people were saying this week, you know, they're stirred to pray about it, but sometimes they don't, how do we pray about this? And how do we do that? And it's not always easy to know what we should pray for or what we should pray against. And some of you will be very familiar with Pete Gregg. He heads up 24/7 prayer. He writes one of probably my favorite book on prayer, How to Pray. If you've never read that book, I really recommend it to you. It's a fabulous book, How to Pray. But he was being interviewed on Premier Radio this week, and they were asking that very question that lots of people are feeling, well, we should pray about this as a Christian, but how do we do that? And he said some things that were just so simple. I've put them up on the screen there. And he just said, remember the three P's. And it really works. And he then went on to do five P's, by the way. That was so I don't know about that. But he said the first P is to pray for the people affected. So that's thinking about those who are displaced, those who are bereaved, those who are frightened, those who are hiding out in basements, those who are fighting on both sides. So we're to think about the people affected. The second P is to pray for pastors and priests. Sorry, that's the third. Sorry, the second P is to pray for politicians and peacemakers. We're told in the Bible that we're to pray for our leaders. We're to always pray for them. So in this situation, we're praying for the president of Ukraine, but also President Putin and for others like Prime Minister Johnson, President Biden, as they seek to make very important decisions. And then the third P is to pray for pastors and priests. We're praying for the church. I read an amazing statistic about Ukraine that 70% identify themselves as Christians. What an amazing work of evangelism, almost revival in that nation, because nobody would have said that 100 years ago. And something has really changed within that nation. And we want to remember pastors and priests there. They're going to, many of them, and we're hearing reports, they are courageously staying put as millions flee. Now, it's that sort of numbers we're talking about. And they're staying put because they're having to bury the dead, and they're having to comfort people. And they'll be seeking to preach the gospel and seeking to fulfill Isaiah 61, bringing good news to the oppressed and the poor and those who are displaced. So maybe that's just, it's almost too simple, but maybe as you're thinking, well, how should I pray? What should I pray for? That might just think of those three P's, and maybe it'll help you to pray as we pray this week, and maybe it'll help us now as we come before God in prayer for others. So let's bow our heads. Father God, you are very great. You are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. You are the President of Presidents, the First Minister of First Ministers. You are sovereign in every area. And we come to humble ourselves. We come, Lord, in our weakness. We come in our helplessness. We come with often a sense of guilt because we can watch terrible scenes on the television and feel so helpless to do actually anything. But thank you, Lord, for the place of prayer. Thank you, Lord, that you have given us this as our only weapon in order to fight the forces of evil in this world. And so we come in prayer and we humble ourselves before you, Almighty God, and say, have mercy upon our world. Be gracious towards us, Lord. We do pray for the people, particularly in Ukraine, Lord. We pray particularly for those who are just terrified for their own existence, their lives, their families, those who are traveling on foot, many sick, many disabled. We pray for those who receive them and pray, Lord, that you would bless those who offer hospitality, who open their homes, who provide practical help and so fulfill the law of Christ to love one another as you have loved us. We pray, Lord, for our politicians, and we pray for those that have the opportunity to be peacemakers in this situation. Lord, we'll be learning today about what true peace means and what price it comes at. But we pray, Lord, that you would be with those who have to stand strong with great resolve in the midst of great fears and great responsibilities. We pray, Lord, that you, Lord, when you speak, you always speak total sense. Lord, when you speak, you always bring those things that will bring about good in people's lives. Lord, speak sense to President Putin. Lord, you can access the most inner, darkest recesses of government and leadership. And so we call upon you, Lord, and that you would speak sense into them and bring a swift end to the tragedies we're seeing on our screens. And Lord, we pray for your church. We pray for pastors and priests. And we're praying for those, Lord, who are remaining in very dangerous areas. We're praying for your church, Lord, as they gather. Lord, protect them, Lord. Many finding refuge in churches and sometimes finding it not being a safe place, still being bombed. Oh, Lord, have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon our world. Lord, we pray against that escalation, Lord, that would wreak devastation across most of the world, including our part of the world. Lord, we come to you. You're our only hope. You are the hope of the world. And Lord Jesus, you are the Prince of Peace. And so hear our cry as we pray for others, as we pray about the situations, Lord, that people are facing day to day, knowing, Lord, that there's lots of things going on round about us, Lord, that we need pray for and need your comfort, the comfort of the Holy Spirit. And let's just take a moment if there's something that's on your mind. It could be on the world stage. It could be very close to home in your family, a bereavement, and you just want to lift up someone in prayer. We're just going to do that silently in our hearts. Bring it before the Lord in prayer. This is a place of peace. This is a house of prayer. Bring it before the Lord. Ask the Savior to help you and to help those in need. And even as we name people before the Lord, let's say that prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray. As we say together, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For yours is the kingdom, the power and the glory forever. Amen. 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 Just a couple of notices. Just a reminder, next week Stan Brick's going to be preaching in the morning. It would be really nice if we could have some tea and coffee. I know some of the cafe staff are going to be making some cakes for us. So if you could serve and prepare some tea and coffee and serve that next week, come and speak to me at the end of the service. And it'd be just really good to be able to do that once again, because we haven't been able to do that for a long time as we celebrate through this year 50 years of Holy Trinity. We've also got some sad news. Many of you will know Ali and Helen Moss. They came to our church for a short while before the pandemic hit, and they moved back up to Orkney. But they've been following us on. They join us online. But Ali, who's been ill for some time now and battling in hospital, but he passed away yesterday, sadly. And our thoughts and our prayers are with Helen and their children in particular. I'm told that the funeral is going to be here in Edinburgh, so I'll give you details of that as soon as I find out about that. It's going to be at Morton Hall, so we remember them in prayer. We're going to turn to God's Word, and of course we're going through the book of Hebrews, and a short passage today, and Hebrews chapter 12 we're in. There's only 13 chapters in Hebrews. Some of you will be relieved to know. We've been here about a year, haven't we, Andy? Yeah? There's so much amazing things in it, though. Maybe it'll be another year. Okay, so Hebrews 12, verse 14. And this is what we read. I'm reading from the New International Version. Make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. See to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, and that no bitter root grows up to cause trouble and defile many. See that no one is sexually immoral or is godless like Esau, who for a single meal sold his inheritance rights as the oldest son. Afterward, as you know, when he wanted to inherit this blessing, he was rejected. Even though he sought the blessing with tears, he could not change what he had done. Amen. May God add his own blessing to that reading of his own holy and inspired word. We'll be thinking about that, particularly that first verse there in verse 14 later on. But let's spend some time. Let's press into the Lord in praise and worship.
Praise to the King of Kings. You are my everything. Temptation comes my way. When I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. When I cannot stand or fall on you, Jesus, you're my hope and stay. Lord, I need you, oh,
wonderful songs of worship there. There is a creche if anyone wants to make use of that, but you're also very welcome in the sanctuary. I don't mind babies crying. I'm very used to it. Well, turn with me, please, to Hebrews chapter 12, and let's pray and ask for God's help. Lord, it's good to be reminded that you are a mighty fortress. We proclaim that the name of the Lord is a strong tower, is a mighty fortress, and the righteous can run to it, and they're safe. And so, Lord, we want to run to you. We want to run into your arms. We want to hear from you through your word today. Speak to us, Lord. Your servants are listening. And so may the speaker decrease so that Jesus Christ of Nazareth would increase, for we ask it in his holy name. Amen. Amen. Well, we read there in Hebrews chapter 12, verse 14, these words, make every effort to live in peace with everyone and to be holy. Without holiness, no one will see the Lord. And I thought it would be appropriate this morning if I just zero in on that, just that really single word there, peace. Because it's a word that we're kind of wondering, what does that mean in a world that we're living in? Right now, what does that peace mean? Now, the first thing I want to say about that is that the peace that we read about here in Hebrews 12 is not about the greatest peace of all, the highest peace of all. That the highest peace of all is peace with God. The Bible tells us so clearly that naturally we are enemies with God. And you know, when I found that out as a teenager, it came as a bit of a shock to the system. Because I had thought that when it really came down to it, that I was one of the good guys. And me and God were great mates. But the Bible tells me that we're naturally, in our minds, enemies with God. We don't want God's rule. We don't want God's rules. We don't want God's lordship in our lives. We're holding him off at length. We've got the hand up and we'll say, stay out of my business, God. I can get on fine by myself. But for many of you here, something began to happen. The Holy Spirit began to work in your heart, began to work in your life. And as the Holy Spirit began to work in your life, you began to realize too, things were not right between you and God. You hadn't been made right with God, and you felt there was a distance between you and God, and something within you went, this is not right. This is not the way it's supposed to be. And the Holy Spirit began to speak to you. And maybe God sent someone into your path and they shared some good news with you. Good news like Romans 5 verse 1, very famous there. Therefore, since we have been made right in God's sight and by faith, we have peace with God because of what Jesus Christ our Lord has done for us. It's a wonderful verse of scripture that through faith, in Christ, we're made right with God, and now there isn't the divide. Jesus, when he went to the cross, he broke down the dividing wall. He ripped the curtain in two, and now we can have peace with God. When I bought my first guitar, I remember putting a sticker on it, and it just said, very cheesy, no peace, no Jesus, no peace, no Jesus, no peace. And the Holy Spirit worked in your life, and he brought you to peace with God. That is the highest peace that you can experience. And it's available to you today because it's through faith in Jesus Christ. And that faith, you can put your trust in him, and you can know peace with God. There is no greater peace. But it's not the peace that we read about here in Hebrews chapter 12, where we read, make every effort to live in peace with everyone. It's talking about the peace between neighbors and peace between communities and peace between nations and peace in the world. And it's not a peace that comes about simply through faith. It's not a peace that comes about through hoping for the best. It's a peace that only comes about with effort. Make every effort to live in peace with everyone. But the peace the Bible speaks about comes about in a way that kind of goes against the grain. But when you look at history, you realize that is exactly the way peace is brought about between neighbors, between communities, between nations. On March the 18th, 1956, Martin Luther King Jr., the great civil rights leader and preacher at that time, he gave a sermon in Dexter Avenue Baptist Church. And he was preaching on the week that a young lady, if we go there, she was called Authorine Lucy. She died just a couple of weeks ago, actually. Authorine Lucy was a brave young black woman who became the first black woman to attend Alabama University. They'd had rules up to that point that no black students were allowed in the university, but they'd fought that, and a federal judge had ordered that they let her attend. She was a very bright student. She had all the grades, and very bravely, she accepted the place when they were forced to accept her. The first day went fine, but the next day, a mob of spoiled students and some criminal networks began to verbally abuse her. They began to burn crosses in front of her face. They started to spit at her. They threw eggs at her. She had to start being accompanied by campus security into the building. She arrived in a car. They would throw bricks at the car. She spoke about times where she would just get into the building and find a room where nobody was, and she closed the door behind her, and she would just pray to Almighty God, not knowing quite what to do. And Martin Luther King Jr. was preaching the week she'd been written to by the university and said, it's probably best if you don't come to the university anymore for your own safety and for the good of the university. And Martin Luther King Jr., he holds up a newspaper headline from the local newspaper. And it said this, all is quiet in Tuscaloosa today. Peace reigns on the campus of the University of Alabama. That was the headline. And this is what he preached that day. Yes, there was peace on campus, but it was a peace that had been purchased at the exorbitant price of an inept trustee board succumbing to the whims and caprices of a vicious mob. It was peace purchased at the price of capitulating to the forces of darkness. This is the type of peace that all men of goodwill hate. It's the type of peace that is obnoxious. It's the type of peace that stinks in the nostrils of Almighty God. See, Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers. But it probably doesn't surprise you to learn that true peacemakers in history, following the word of Christ, were not those who went, why can't we all just get along? They were not the sort of people who turned a blind eye to injustice, which was to let evil flourish. Because bringing about true peace on earth involves confrontation. You see, Jesus, he brought about the greatest peace of all, that peace that we can have with God. But in order to bring about that peace, Jesus had to confront all the forces of darkness arrayed against him, the enemy arrayed against him, evil coming against him, suffering and dying on that cross. Because bringing about true peace involves confronting those things that are evil. It involves confronting those things that bring about injustice, because there can't be true peace unless those things that actually destroy peace in our community are confronted. And so true peacemakers are not those who don't confront the scourge of domestic violence that goes on in our city. I was hearing some figures this week. It is terrifying. True peace doesn't come about without confronting the scourge of drugs and the industry and the lives that are ruined round about. Because true peace involves confrontation. And I want to share with you a testimony. It's a wonderful testimony that I think really illustrates what I mean by that and what the Bible means by that. I came across the testimony in all of places by an address that was given by the then president, Ronald Reagan, when he was invited to address the National Prayer Breakfast in America. And he told a story, a true story, about a man called Telemachus. He's called Saint Telemachus in the Roman Catholic Church. He's not to be confused with Telemachus in Homer's Odyssey, if you're a well-read sort of person and that. He's a fictional character. This is Saint Telemachus. He was a fourth century monk. He was from Asia Minor. It's kind of modern-day Turkey nowadays. And he loved God. He was, by all accounts, just a little guy. But he would spend weeks and months in prayer in lonely desert places. He would study the scriptures and meditate upon it day and night. And people would come to him for his wisdom and for his counsel from all around. He probably had a pretty peaceful existence, but one day as he was praying, he sensed the Holy Spirit say to him, "You're to go to Rome." And Telemachus heard that call to go to Rome, not knowing why he was being sent to Rome or what he would find when he got there. But he made the long, arduous journey all the way into Rome. The day he arrived on the streets of Rome, he noticed that the crowds and crowds of people, they seemed to be all going in one direction. And so he decided, well, I'll just go with the crowd and I'll follow them. And he ended up in the great Colosseum in Rome. And as he stands with the crowd there in the great Colosseum, he's horrified to hear thousands and thousands of people baying for blood because on the arena floor, the gladiators are fighting. And they're killing one another for sport. And the crowd are loving it. And Telemachus is horrified by this. He's absolutely horrified because the city of Rome had only recently been dedicated to Christ. And as another gladiator plunged his sword into another and killed him, perhaps as many slaves on the arena floor, we know there were lions there as well, Telemachus, stirred in his spirit, runs out onto the arena floor. And the crowd is shocked to see someone from the crowd running onto the arena floor. And there's a kind of hush that goes over the crowd. And it's captured in many, many paintings, famous paintings. But Telemachus, he puts his hand out and he cries at the top of his lungs, "In the name of Christ, forbear." And the crowd hear this and they start to boo him. And so he cries out once again, "In the name of Christ, forbear." And now they start to get angry because he's spoiling their fun. He's spoiling their entertainment. A third time, he puts his hand up and he says, in the name of Christ, desist from this. And a mob run onto the field and they stone him. The historian Theodoret records, and they stoned him to death. But I want to tell you something. That was the last gladiator fight that was fought in the Colosseum. Because the emperor, who wasn't there that day, heard about what had happened. And he was so horrified by it, he brought an end that brutal, wicked sport where people would enjoy for their entertainment watching people killing one another. Because this is the way true peace comes about. It's when somebody in the name of Christ goes without the weapons of this world, and that's very important, without the weapons of this world. And they go in the name of Christ, often putting themselves in harm's way, often at the cost of their own lives or their own well-being, just as Christ did on the cross. And he brings an end. And you can look it up later on Google about that was the end of the gladiatorial fighting in Rome. How one man could make a difference when he takes a stand for peace. But he could have just gone along with the crowd. I think the modern way of thinking about peace was, well, just let everyone, let bygones be bygones. Let just everyone get on with what they want to do. But that makes you a false prophet. It's what Jeremiah warned about. He warned about the prophets who were all saying, all the false prophets were saying, peace, peace, when there is no peace. Because peace between our neighbors and peace between our communities, peace between our nations, it only comes about when evil is confronted without the weapons of this world. And remember that. That's the way history shows it. I've just heard so many testimonies of people going into communities devastated by violence and drugs and taking a stand for Jesus at personal cost to themselves, but something happening. And often something awful happens, but God changes it around. He uses it for good. Because these are people who are true heroes of their faith, and they're not looking for their reward in this life. They're looking for their reward in the life to come. And I think people like Telemachus, I think he's recorded. He's not recorded in the heroes of the faith in Hebrews chapter 11. He wasn't born yet. But I think he gets on the supplementary list in heaven of those who took their stand for Christ without the weapons of this war and were willing to confront those things that would truly bring peace. I'm crying out to the Lord in prayer, Lord, would you strengthen your people in Ukraine and in Russia right now to be so brave like some of the saints of old, so brave that without the weapons of war could confront those things that are evil and bring about a miracle. Because that's the way it happens in history. The trouble with wars is they just create more wars. There's another battle to fight. It's a bit like in school. When my brother was being bullied by someone, and so he turned on him and beat up the bully. And then everybody else wanted to fight him after that, just to prove they were. But it just creates another war. There's a different way. And the Bible talks about peace in a very specific sense. But what about us? We're not facing invading forces, God forbid. But what about in our own lives? Are there things that would bring about peace that we might have to confront, and it might not be very easy for us. Well, let's just read the rest of the verses. We haven't got a lot of time, so I'm not going to go into them. I just want you to, just want the people of God to hear the word of God. Let the word of God stir the people of God. Verse 15, see to it that no one falls short of the grace of God, and that no root of bitterness grows up to cause trouble and defile many. If you want to find out about some of the deeper meaning of this, go and have a look at Deuteronomy chapter 28 later on today, and you'll see about this root of bitterness. But let's just take it on just the surface level, or just a first level reading of bitterness, how bitterness can manifest itself in unforgiveness, how it manifests itself in jealousy, how it manifests itself in churches, when we feel disappointed, when someone didn't do something for us that they should have done, or they haven't done that. And the Bible talks about how a root of bitterness can get into our hearts and our minds. And I received a word this morning, emailed to me first thing this morning, and it was talking about these very things. And it was saying how we really need to guard our hearts as we come in worship, because it begins as like a film that goes around our hearts, and we need to deal with those heart issues. Because it's no good the church talking about peace if we can't be at peace with one another, because that's where it starts, in how it really affects us day to day, and learning to forgive when people have wronged us. And learning to move on when we feel disappointed by others, by another Christian, or someone who was supposed to be a Christian and they did this to me, or disappointed in church, or whatever that film that gets around our hearts and leaves a distance between one another. It's no good wanting peace somewhere else when the Bible talks about we're to have fellowship with one another. To love one another. See to it that no bitter root grows up to trouble and defile many, and many churches have been defiled by that. Verse 16, see that no one is sexually immoral. Is that something that you're going to have to take a peaceful, without the weapons of this world, stand on? You know, if you've read the Scottish curriculum for what they share with in our secondary schools about sex, and you'd be horrified by the content of that, every perversion against what the Word of God says, where sex is to be kept for marriage between a man and a woman, and the marriage bed is to be kept pure and holy. That's what the Bible says. That's what God's word says. But try standing up in some circumstances and you'll feel exactly like Telemachus, with the crowd baying for your blood, that you dare speak up against whatever sexual perversion is allowed in the latest one. And they change every day. But maybe you'll have to do that, because it's the only thing that's going to bring true peace instead of the sexual insanity that has come over some of our young people, and they're just kind of lost in a sea, not knowing who they are and who God has made them and how precious and special they are in God's sight. See to it that no one is sexually immoral, or the final thing here, or is godless like Esau, who for a single meal sold his inheritance rights as the oldest son. Afterward, as you know, when he wanted to inherit the blessing, he was rejected. Even though he sought the blessing with tears, he could not change what he had done. We don't have time to go into that. It deserves a sermon all of its own. But just to say, just on the surface level, about what needs to be confronted if we're going to really bring peace, that peace that changes communities, changes our world, changes the way people treat one another, changes the way that we are treated. We know that Esau, he was willing to trade something that was spiritual and eternal for something that was worldly and temporary. And that temptation is just so common for everyone, for me, for you in this world. Don't do it. Don't trade those things that are eternal and spiritual for those things that are worldly. And they only last a short while. Because these are the sort of things that bring discord in our lives. They're not the things that bring peace. I put up a final screen. If we go onto the final screen there, you'll see. This is what's recorded in history about Telemachus. It's a wonderful story. When the admirable emperor was informed of this, he numbered Telemachus in the number of victorious martyrs, and he put an end to that impious, that unholy spectacle. Let's just come before God in prayer. Lord Jesus, you said, if you only had known the things that would bring peace, but it's hidden from you now. Lord, we pray for those things that maybe has been hidden from us, that you would open our eyes by your Holy Spirit and through your word. The things that truly bring peace in the biblical sense. We know, Lord Jesus, though you are the Prince of Peace, you have also come to bring a sword. Not that you accepted anybody fighting on your behalf or wielding a sword, but you came to bring a dividing line between good and evil, between justice and injustice, between the forces of light and the forces of darkness. And Lord, may we be found on that side that bring peace and not chaos. And for any, Lord, who are having to take a stand on your word, whether far away from us in another country or here in Scotland, in our workplaces, in our schools, in our offices, in our churches. Lord, make us strong in you, standing for those things that will truly bring peace. Prince of Peace, may those things that are from you today, Lord, nestle, rest within our hearts. May we carry them into the coming weeks and months, especially when we're faced with tricky decisions on how we're to act. And Lord, if anything I've spoken is not from you, Lord, may it just fall away and be forgotten in an instant. Hear our prayer, for we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. If somebody would like to go and get the children, that would be great. And we're just going to sing a song of worship in response as the children come back in.
Well, let's stand together and sing. Mine are days that God has numbered. I was made to walk with him. Yet I look for worldly treasure and forsake the King of Kings. But mine is hope. Mine are tears.
Talk amongst yourselves for 30 seconds as the children just make their way back. And here they come. Oh, they go. Let's give them a big clap as they come back in. And Naomi Black's going to come up and share with us a little bit about what the children have been doing.
In chatterboxes this morning, we'd only just finished this activity, as you might be able to tell. We have been learning about, can anyone remember who we've learned about today?
Joseph,
yeah. And we're not Joseph, the father of Jesus, but Joseph in the Old Testament. No, it wasn't Joshua. And Fraser is going to read the verse that we've learned about today.
But Joseph said to them, "Don't be afraid. I can put myself in the place of God." 20. You plotted evil against me, but God turned it into good in order to preserve the lives of many people who are alive today because of what happened. Genesis 15, v 16 to 20.
Wow. Well done, Fraser. We learned about how God used all the things that happened in Joseph's life, the things that felt really rubbish, the things that felt good. He used it all for good, and not just for Joseph, but for all the people that Joseph's lives helped as well. And we made some technical dream coats, or dream outfits, and we didn't quite get around to our book. We're going to finish with a song
Golden
today.
Valley.
This one's called Golden Belly. Apparently, this outfit is very flattering. We're going to finish with a worship song today. It's not a kids' action song. It's a worship song called You Never Let Go. And we didn't sing it yet downstairs, but just to think again about through the highs and lows in life that God never lets go of us, just the same way he did for Joseph.
Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I won't fear no
Well, thank you, Lord, that that is so true. You never let go of us. Lord, you've got us in your hands, and your hands are strong. And so now may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you all and all whom you love and cherish and all God's people here and everywhere, both now and forevermore. Amen. God bless you all. Thanks for coming this morning.
saints and angels bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing. Saints and angels, they bow before your throne. All the elders cast their crowns before the Lamb of God and sing that you are worthy of it all.
To you.